For him, it could go either way. But that is not faith at all. James wrote, let him ask in faith. What is faith? Faith is confidence in knowing that the things we hope for, the things we ask for, even though we've never seen them, are going to come about. And when we look at faith, there are two things that, there's another thing that goes with faith. When we look at faith, faith is the substance of things hoped for. So when we look at faith, faith and hope go hand in hand. Those two are connected somehow. You cannot have hope without, well, I should say this, you cannot have faith without hope. When we look, and once again, when we're doing our in-depth Bible study, we've looked at faith, and now hope is connected. So what's the first thing we're going to do? We're going to go back to the same thing we did with faith. We're going to start finding out what hope means, what it stands for. And I like to say, one of the first places I go is, I'm going to go to the dictionary. And according to Merriam-Webster's Online Dictionary, hope is defined in this manner. To cherish a desire with anticipation. To want something to happen or to be true. Such as hoping for a promotion. If we go a little bit archaic in its meaning, it means trust. It also means to desire with expectation of fulfillment or obtainment. When we look at the definition of faith in Hebrews chapter 11, verse 1, does not hope go exactly along with that? To desire with expectation of fulfillment or obtainment. Desire with expectation. There's no wavering, there's no maybe it might happen or won't. But there is confidence that it is going to happen. Or to expect with confidence. When we look at the Greek word for hope, it comes from the Greek word elpizo. And it means to expect or confide. It occurs in 31 verses of the New Testament. And if we were going to get a biblical definition for hope, probably the greatest place we can go, at least in my mind's eye, is Romans chapter 8 and verse 25. Romans 8, 25. Yeah, go ahead, Maria.
But if we hope for that we see not, then we with patience wait for it.
But if we hope for that we see not, then do we with patience wait for it. When we look at hope, it's more like a trusting or a confidence. And that goes right back to faith. When we look at hope, it's not a maybe it will happen, but it will happen. But if we hope for that we see not, then do we with patience wait for it. When we go back to Romans 8:25, we do not see hope. If we would place there, maybe it will happen, it doesn't fit there. The only thing we have in Romans 8:25 is a confidence. If we hope for that we see not, then do we with patience wait for it. It is a confidence that it will happen. And when we look at faith, it just shows us more and more that faith and hope go together. And it has nothing to do with a maybe it will happen or it might happen. But both words point us back to confidence. Not being double-minded, but the fact that it will happen. I'm confident. I know in whom I believe, and he's able to do exceedingly above anything I can ask or think. And I know that if I ask him, it will happen. It all comes back to this. If we say that we have faith, and we pray with the maybe, might be, will be mentality, the Bible tells us and defines us as being a double-minded man. So true biblical faith comes down to the fact that we have confidence in that we hope for it, even if we don't see it. So faith is believing that something will happen and having confidence that it will happen, even if we don't see the answer anywhere in sight. And when we look at Romans 8:25, we compare to Hebrews 11:1, it all goes back to having confidence, not wavering. And when we look at Hebrews 11, brother, as you said earlier, Hebrews 11 is a great place to go. Because one thing that we've had in school, and I will wrap things up, but if we're going to learn something new in school, say addition, subtraction, if you're going to learn how to conjugate a verb, if we're going to learn how to diagram a sentence, what is going to be the first thing they're going to do? They're going to give you instructions on what to do. Find the sum of these items. Find the sum of 2 + 2. But if you've never done it before, they are going to provide instruction. And immediately underneath that, they are going to give you an example. Because sometimes instructions aren't just enough. We can have words, but okay, what am I supposed to do with this? Especially the first time we're doing anything. It helps to have an example. When I'm going to learn how to do anything for the first time, I'm going to sit down probably with somebody who knows how to do it, and I'm going to sit and get a diagram or something. I'm a very visual person. I had my pap come and help me with electrical work. Could I have done it on my own? Yeah, I had the gist in my head. Yes, but I wanted that example to go off of future reference. Why? Because it gave me confidence that I knew what I was doing and that it was going to be done effectively. So we have instruction, and then we have an example. In Hebrews 11:1, we have exactly that. What does Hebrews 11:1 start off with? Instruction. It gives us the definition of faith. Faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. And then what happens in verse 2? God gives us an example. In Hebrews 11:2, does somebody have that? 11:2. Let's go to verse 3.
Through faith we understand that the world was framed by the word of God, so that the things which are seen were not made of the things which still appear.
So we go back to the very beginning, and God tells us that by faith were the worlds framed. So he starts giving us examples. So through confidence were the worlds framed through the spoken word of God. If we look at Genesis 1, we take that by faith. What does that mean? We take it with confidence and a surety, knowing that God said it, it happened that way. We find that in Hebrews 11:3, that the worlds were framed through faith, through confidence. The more we read the word of God, we have confidence that God made something, took nothing, hung in the middle of nothing, and created something. We take that all with confidence that God said it is true. We don't question it. We know without a shadow of a doubt it was true. And when the farther we go down through Hebrews 11, God gives us example upon example upon example exactly what faith is. By faith, or with confidence, Abraham looked for a city which hath foundations, whose builder and maker was God. Did Abraham ever see this city in his lifetime? No. But by faith, he kept sojourning and going throughout Mesopotamia, kept going throughout the Middle East, looking for the city that had foundations, whose builder and maker was God. What is that? Not something wavering. It wasn't a rebuttal of God as it was found in the, as we read earlier in Matthew and Luke, O ye little faith, but it was a faith that had confidence that one day I'm going to see it. One day I'm going to see it. And even there, in Abraham's bosom, he still probably did not see it in its completion. He might see it through spiritual eyes, but we know that Jesus didn't start building the city until after he returned to heaven. So Abraham looked with confidence. The elders obtained a good report through confidence, knowing that as long as they did what God said, that one day that they would be with him. And I'm going to stop there for the sake of time. But when we look at biblical definition, the biblical definition of faith, it is simply the confidence of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. Even though we don't see it, we know and have confidence that it's true. And faith and hope are tied together through this word of confidence. And neither one of those two words indicate a going back in any way. It doesn't matter. They do not indicate any possibility of the word maybe, might, but rather they all point to the fact of having confidence that's going to happen even if we don't see it. And Hebrews 11:13, we'll just close with this. These all died in faith, not having received the promises, but having seen them afar off, and were persuaded of them, and embraced them, and confessed that they were strangers and pilgrims on the earth. They died in faith. They died having confidence that one day they will receive their reward. They will receive exactly what was promised of God. Does anybody have any thoughts, any questions, anything they want to add at this point? I'm just going to walk around. Do you want to say anything, Daniel? Yes. Confidence. how much could we see God do in our own life? Would we step out more? Would we lay hands on the sick in public places? Would we see people get out of wheelchairs in public places that were once bound by them? People throw crutches to the side, whether it be Walmart, whether it be Warriors, whether we're walking down the street. If only we would develop faith and culture in every area of our life, how much more could God do through us? And would we see more signs and wonders happen because of it? Because the truth of the matter is, if we get down to it, and we're honest with ourselves, the church world that we're living in, how many times do we see signs and wonders happen? If we were to be honest, and we would look outward, how many people do we think we would see that are willing to be used of God to see these things happen in the church world as a whole? And if the majority of the people aren't willing to step out in faith to see things happen, then who does it fall on? If we truly want to see signs and wonders happen, it falls on us. If no one else are seeing signs and wonders happen, it falls on us. And signs and wonders are the true mark of Christianity. We live in an area that is strongly church. We live in an area that's strongly religious. To be honest, it's probably been that way for how many centuries and millenniums. It doesn't matter. You go into any part of the world, they're all religious. But what's going to make our church different from any other Pentecostal church in the area, any other Lutheran church? It's going to be when we see signs and wonders happen. It's one thing to have the presence of God. Yes, that can set us apart. But you know what's really going to make people take notice? Is when signs and wonders start following them that believe. And it only comes when we start practicing our faith and having confidence that what God said will happen. And that in itself can be a scary part. And it can be a scary place. Because that means we have to step outside of our comfort zone. And we have to step out into areas that we might be proven in our own mind to be a fool. To step up and walk up to some stranger and say, I feel like God wants to heal you. Can I pray? Lay my hands on you and we'll pray for you. That takes stepping outside of our comfort zone. Here in the future, I would love to do a series called Becoming a Powerful Pentecostal or something to that degree. No, Pentecostal Powerhouse. But, like everything else, it all begins before you can become proficient in anything. It takes stepping outside of our comfort zone and practicing, taking baby steps. Because the only reason that we can feed ourselves with a spoon is that it took practice. The only reason that we can walk, and not all of us can walk that well because we still trip and stumble over things, is because we kept doing it over and over and over. You know, even if we don't see results at first, we need to keep acting in confidence, knowing that God will answer our petitions. When Paul rebuked the fortune-telling girl, does the Bible say that the demon came out exactly right then and there? And does the Bible say that Paul hung around if it did? If we get down to Acts chapter 16, the actual wording of it is, when Paul rebuked that devil, it says it came out within the gal. But nowhere in that passage does it state that Paul hung around and kept praying for her. It doesn't say that he didn't either, but it doesn't say that he stayed and tarried there. He might have just said, come out in the name of Jesus, and he walked away. And that devil could have stayed within her. But within that hour, it came out. Confidence, faith is having confidence that whatsoever we ask in God's name, it will be done, even if we don't see it happen right then and right there. Okay, I'm shutting down. Anybody have anything else they want to add? Okay, all hearts clear? Then if we all stand, and Brother Peterman, would you dismiss us in prayer?